So far we've discussed planets like Pluto that orbit far from their sun, and tidally locked worlds which orbit very close to their sun. Today we'll be looking at worlds that don't orbit suns at all. Moon is a pretty broad concept, as a tome just means any decently sized object in a reasonably stable orbit around a planet. They can vary in size from a rock a few miles across to things that are bigger than other planets. Our own moon is bigger than Pluto, and Jupiter's moon Ganymede is larger than the planet Mercury. The only size limit is that they can't be bigger than the planet they orbit, since if they were, the relationship would be backwards. But in practice, we would normally deem any moon of similar mass to its planet to be a double planet. There's no rigorous definition of a double planet, but we'd usually say anything less than a tenth of the other planet's mass counts as a moon. We'll look at double planets another time. Life on moons like frozen Europa or Saturn's moon Titan are also interesting possibilities, but today we won't be looking at those either. Our subject today is going to be a pretty long one just by itself. We'll be focusing on worlds which differ from ideal planets of Earth-like mass only in that they are moons, presumably in orbit around gas giants. Same mass and composition, same day-night length. To avoid confusion, we're going to refer to these as Gaian moons. We'll save the other cases for another day. Regarding them briefly, though, before moving on to our main subject, the key difference between a moon and an asteroid or a dwarf planet in terms of habitability is that they will receive tidal heating. As we've mentioned previously, the single biggest factor we look for in terms of life arising on a world is if there's enough energy coming in to it to supply power to biological life and permit temperatures in which the right kind of chemical interactions are commonplace. We touched on that more in the video on Pluto, and we'll talk about it a lot more in the future. If you have two otherwise identical large asteroids much further away from the sun than Earth is, but one is a captured moon, then that one has all the extra power input of tidal heating to supplement its meager supply of sunlight, which also applies to Earth-like worlds that are moons of gas giants. They can get away with being a bit further from the sun than Earth is and still be warm enough for life. All planets don't use most of the sunlight that hits them at noontime, so if there's another power source keeping the moon warm, the moon could be further from the sun than Earth is. Indeed, they probably can't exist as close to the sun as we are, or they'd be baked by the extra influx of energy from both sources, tidal and solar. Now, the difference between a moon and a planet, in terms of habitability, doesn't stop there. There are two major factors which also apply. The first is tidal locking, which we discussed in detail both last time and the companion video on tidal locking. Like all video links I use in these videos, you can click on this one and it will just pause the video and open the other in a new window. So you may want to do so now if you're not familiar with the subject. So let's talk about Gaian moons. If a planet becomes tidally locked to a star, it has eternal daylight on one side and eternal night on the other. Moons locked to a planet are different. As we discussed, there's no dark side of the moon, just a side we can never see from Earth. We've also discussed why almost every moon is eventually going to end up tidally locked. Again, click the tidal locking video link if you're not familiar with that. So a moon tidally locked to a planet is going to have a day and night cycle. All moons' day-night cycle is a month long, which is also the lunar day and the lunar year. Same concept applies to Earth-sized moons. Throughout this video, we will use the term day to mean the moon's day-night length cycle, rather than saying year or month, since in this case they are all the same length. Now, that moon wouldn't have to have a 24-hour day for life to be possible, but the table I've got up shows the distance a moon of Earth mass needs to be from a planet to have a 24-hour orbit. Our Gaian moon case. Here's also a simplified equation that you can use if you want to calculate Gaian moon distance from planets of different masses, or if you want to calculate it for an Earth mass moon with a different day length than ours. Pause the video if you want to review these, as I don't want to turn this video into a math lesson. They're just Keplers Laws simplified for this specific type of case, an Earth mass moon. The distance up there are only accurate for a roughly circular orbit. For eccentric orbits, those would be the semi-major axis. Similarly, in a moment I'll bring up the diameters of planets, and that is they're going to be the equatorial diameter. Planets are rarely perfect spheres, and gas giants in particular tend to be wider at the equator than their poles. But we're looking at approximations here, so I will just be calling these distances and diameters. As you can see in the table, I have our four gas giant worlds, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune, already listed. But I've also got six other examples. three at the beginning which are essentially double planet scenarios, which again we'll discuss more in the future, and three at the end for a larger gas giant, one 1,000 times Earth's mass, then one about 13 Jupiter masses, generally considered to be the point at which gas giants become brown dwarf stars, and finally a minimum mass red dwarf star, one that is just massive enough to ignite stellar fusion. We'll talk about life around brown dwarf stars another day as well. In a moment, I'm going to talk about how big these objects are in the night sky of their Gaia and Moon, compared to how big the Sun and Moon are in our own sky. But let me mention the Roche limit briefly, since it occasionally gets mentioned in regard to habitable moons. The Roche limit is the minimum distance a moon can be from a planet, or a planet from a star, before it gets shredded by gravity. The more massive the moon, the closer it can be because its own gravity holds it together better, even though its bigger diameter makes the tidal strain on it higher. Simply put, the Roche limit is essentially never relevant to planetary habitability when we're talking about close Earth parallels like Gaia and moons, because the distance they have to be to have an orbital period of a day, or anything approximating a day, is well beyond the Roche limit. And the distance a planet needs to be from even the dimmest main sequence star and not be roasted is also well outside the Roche limit. It can be a concern for moons where we aren't contemplating surface life, but that's not our concern today. So what does a planet look like from the surface of our Gaian moon? First, since it is tidally locked, you can only see the planet from one side of the moon, where it will always be visible, and not from the other side. Though moons on fairly eccentric orbits will still have a wide band around the poles where it will sometimes be visible and sometimes not, due to a force called libration, as we discussed last time in the tidally locked planets video. For those who can see it, the planet will be very large. Our table here shows how large, in terms of how big our moon appears to be in our night sky. What's interesting is that while the planet will appear larger and larger as it gets more massive, it will actually peak out when you get to about Saturn size. Not only is the distance the Gaian moon is from the planet rising as the planet's mass rises, so that objects appear smaller, but the density of gas giants starts rising about then too. Earth is the densest planet in our solar system, because the bigger planets are mostly made of ice and gas. Saturn is less dense than Neptune and Uranus because it is mostly gas, whereas Neptune, for instance, is slightly smaller than Uranus, but slightly more massive. It is denser because it has a rocky core slightly more massive than Earth, than a thick mantle composed of ices, water, methane, and ammonia. But Jupiter is much denser than Saturn, yet it is still almost all hydrogen. Why? Well, simply put, at a certain point, gravity kicks in and compresses planets a lot more. Brown dwarfs, even though they are a dozen to several dozen times more massive than Jupiter, are all about the same size as Jupiter, just much denser. So to people living on a Gaian moon, the visual size of their planet in the night sky begins to slowly rise until you get to be about Saturn's size. It then peaks out and begins to drop off slowly as the planet stops getting much bigger as their masses increase, while the moon's distance continues to get larger to keep that 24-hour day. Then at roughly Jupiter masses, the apparent size is going to drop off even more steeply. This is very like the effect we noted when discussing red dwarfs last time, that the smaller stars look bigger on their habitable worlds because you have to be much closer to them to stay warm. Now, this massive planet-moon in the sky has a big effect on the nighttime brightness, too. While on the backside of the Gaian moon they don't see a planet, they will likely see the planet's other moons. Yet on the front side they will always see that moon, and it is terribly bright, roughly on par with the square of the diameter. Our own full moon is nowhere near as bright as our sun, even less than it seems because our eyes are logarithmic to light. But if you made it 20 times brighter in the sky, it would be 20 squared times brighter, 400 times brighter than now. Gas giants also have higher albedos than our moon, about 4 times higher on average, so they would look even brighter. If we plopped Saturn down next to us and stuck Earth in it in a 24-hour orbit around it, it would appear about 20,000 times brighter than our own moon. Now, brightness is a very weird concept and hard to compare, to put it simply. In that case, the planet would appear to be nearly as bright as the sun. Especially considering that in order for a Gaian moon to be habitable with all that reflected light and tidal heating from the planet, as well as infrared emissions, the Gaian moon would need to be further from the sun anyway. So the planet in the sky is going to stay more or less stationary in the sky, day or night, wobbling a bit from libration, and going through phases like our own moon does. Both sides of the planet are habitable, but the planet side will be warmer than the dark side, which again is not actually dark, but will be a bit cooler. Now, if that were all of it, we could stop and say that any moon of similar mass to Earth with a day length reasonably similar to Earth's would be just as habitable as Earth. Unfortunately, gas giants are massive sources of radiation, which, as a side note, would make for some truly massive auroras on giant moons. We mentioned last time how planets around red dwarfs need strong magnetic fields to avoid having their atmosphere stripped off by their sun, and the same concept applies to moons of gas giants. In the case of a Gaian moon, it would have to have a strong magnetic field, but it would be further shielded from its sun by its planet's own huge magnetosphere. Which is good, except that they also get inundated by radiation from the planet's own magnetosphere. Our magnetosphere shields us from the sun's radiation, but a byproduct of that is the Van Allen radiation belt, where radiation is actually a lot stronger than it normally is in space. Gas giants have a similar but stronger setup, and many of their moons are right in that radiation belt. It's not really possible for me to give you even a loose rule of thumb for how bad that radiation will be, because there are so many variables involved. Even a planet's rings can kick in to partially reduce the radiation, for instance. But we can say it is a big problem for moons, but ironically a smaller one for the two types of possibly habitable moons we're interested in. Ones like Europa, where life would be hypothetically under the ocean, deep underneath a frozen ice layer in the seas, would be protected from radiation and wouldn't need an atmosphere. And ones like our hypothetical Gaian moons, where a strong magnetosphere is very likely to exist and shield the atmosphere from being stripped away. It's quite possible that wouldn't be enough, and as we've mentioned with red dwarf planets, it may be that none can maintain an atmosphere. But we do have an example of Saturn's moon Titan, which has a thick nitrogen atmosphere even though it is far less massive than Earth. Though it is also 6 times further away from Saturn than a Gaian moon would be, which reduces the radiation it gets. Still, the habitability of Gaian moons around gas and ice giant planets looks very promising, not just for simple life, but quite possibly for complex life like us. So the Star Wars-style forest moon of Endor, or Yavin 4, are definitely in the realm of the plausible to the best of our knowledge. In terms of colonization, we obviously don't have any Gaian moons in our solar system. Ganymede is the largest moon, but it's still tiny compared to Earth and has a rotation period of a week. Titan's about 2 weeks, incidentally. Both are far too cold for Earth-like surface life, too. But if we did find a Gaian moon around another star, it would be a fairly straightforward colonization. Hard to find something much better than a thing with Earth-like mass, composition, and day-night cycles, after all. And as I mentioned last time, you can boost a planet or a moon's magnetosphere by placing large solar-powered magnets in orbit around the thing. These would actually work very well in tandem with something like an orbital ring if you've been following our megastructural series. Speaking of the megastructural series, we'll be returning to that for our next episode on Lofsum loops and other constructs for launching objects into orbit before returning to this series. In the next episode of this series, we'll be looking at the possibility of life on rogue planets, objects that aren't in orbit around any star at all. If you want to be alerted to when that or other videos come out, hit the subscribe button. And don't forget to like and share this video if you've enjoyed it, and try out the other videos in this series, or in my other two series, The Fermi Paradox and Megastructurals. Comments and questions are welcome below, and please let me know which type of planets you'd like us to look at next. As always, thanks for watching, and have a great day.